right? Boy, he's just so close. I don't know what this means. But today, some of us are in this room. We've had a lot more than that. And just think about all the different times in which we've been together and different people that we've seen over the years. And it's just amazing. And in Oklahoma, the weather usually changes around Christmas time. And so we start feeling that desire of come together and be together for the feast and push them out like butterflies. Not so many this year, but I did see a few of them flying around, which is always a kind of an indication that that time is there. And anyway, I want to encourage everyone to come to the feast, and those that may be listening and maybe you cannot get out, please come out and join us on the internet if you can, and rejoice at the feast, because that's what it's all about. We are acting out that plan of God that God has set forth in this holy word. And as Tim said, this is another time in which we can come before God and reason and understand His truth. In the how do I want to put this? The Jews had a yearly thing that they do on the Day of Atonement, which is read the Book of Jonah. Well, this year I decided that I would do that. And all of a sudden, Jonah was really, really interesting. I began to see some things that I hadn't seen before, and maybe everyone here has already seen them. So. But it's quite a short little book, only four chapters, very few verses, but there's a lot of interesting stuff in the book of Jonah that just really is quite profound, because it shows something of God's nature and His desire that no one perish. Whatever He can do to keep people from perishing, He will do it, even if it's just a temporary thing. And so, the book of Jonah is an interesting little book. And I'm just winging it, and you all have maybe some other thoughts and things. So I'm just going to make this a sermon of the book of Jonah, and we're just going to go through it. And I'm not going to read every verse, because I've got some thoughts that are there. But the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, the great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." What does that tell you about God? That He sits there and is oblivious to what's going on in the world? Or does this tell you that God is always aware of what's going on in the world, in the lives that people are living, and how the world is going, and how it is becoming more and more wicked in its own way as we approach before? We know that eventually the kingdom will come because of the wickedness of the world, and it will come to a point in which all of mankind will come to the brink of total disaster, because man will try to destroy one another. Now, Jonah. Jonah means dove. So God's going to send a dove to the most wicked city in the world at that time, which was Nineveh. But Jonah, I love this, because Jonah says, "Oh, well, wait a minute, you're going to send me there." So Jonah goes and flee to the opposite direction. He says, "I'm going to go to Tarshish, you want me to go to Nineveh. And I want to go this way, you want me to go that way." in the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa, found a ship going to Tarsus, so he paid the fare and went down into it to go with them to Tarsus from the presence of the Lord. From the presence of the Lord. Now, remember what David said about being hiding from the presence of the Lord. There is no way. No matter where you go, God knows where you're at, where you're at. Well, okay, I think this guy got a little exasperated when he said, you go do this. When I was, I think all of us have stories. So we all have the beginning stories of our life. So what happened at the beginning of our life? When God began to call us, I think that's, to me, that was essentially the beginning of my life. When God began to work in my life was the beginning, of, truly the beginning of my life. And I was sitting, as I said before, on Zenith Radio, listening to a booming voice telling me all about what the Bible says. Well, at 10 years old, that's, it's not very difficult to understand that that just kind of went over my head. Because I was really wanting to listen to music or different other stories that were on the radio. And at that time, it was easy to find. Coming on from Carter Sermon, they making a lot of preaching about the kingdom of God. And don't believe me, you read the Bible and get it out and look at it and see if it isn't true. And you preach and preach and preach that truth. Powerful. So, here I was at that age, and it kind of went over my head, and my mother started taking the blame for this, and all of the different things that were going on in my life. And so, there were different opportunities to actually accept Christ as my personal Savior when I was young. Now, as a teenager, it was like, oh, what? Tell me. I wanted to go this way. God wanted me to go that way. So, you had to come and, lead me back a little bit like you did Jonah. And he did after many, many difficult times and a lot of things that I regret and had to repent of. And we find out that also Jonah did the same. So, what does God do to get Jonah to do the right thing? So, we find out the Lord sent out a great wind. Jonah's in this ship. And so he sends out this great wind, and the tempest is so great, it's just rocking this ship. And the mariners were afraid. they've been in the ship, and it was getting really bad. And every man cried out to his God and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But where was Jonah? Jonah had gone down into the lowest parts of the ship, and it lay down and was fast asleep. Now, this thing is rocking back and forth, tipping back and forth like this, because God has sent this giant, huge waves and all of this. And he was sound asleep. It's interesting, I think in some of those ships, they actually have, hammocks. So they hang them on, nails. And you lay in this hammock and put, you just kind of get rocked back and forth. And of course, as that ship is going and rocking, he's more. But he was sound asleep. And so the captain came down to him and said to him, what do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish. And they said to one another, come, let us cast lots that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us. So they cast lots, and lot fell upon Jonah. Interesting enough. Then they said to him, please tell us for whose cause this trouble is on us. And what is your occupation, and where do you come from? And what is your country, and what people are you? Boy, they were asking a lot of questions because they were desperate. Come on, Jonah, let me know what's going on with this. And he says, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made sea and the dry land. And then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, why have you done this? for the men knowing that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he had told them so. Okay. Then they said to him, what shall we do to you? Oh boy. What shall we do that the sea may be calm for us? For the sea was growing more tempestuous. And he said to them, pick me up and throw me into the sea. I wanted to stop right here, and I wanted to just think about some things that are in the New Testament that relate somewhat to this, to our Savior Jesus Christ. First of all, when Jesus came up out of the baptism of John, and he came up, what was given to him at that time? Was it the Holy Spirit? And what was the Holy Spirit coming down on us? Jonah, a dove. It came down as a dove. What did Jesus do? Did Jesus run from his commission that he was given? No. The first thing Jesus does is he confronts his commission by going to battle with Satan. The Spirit leads him in to the wilderness to battle Satan. Unlike Jonah, Jesus knew what his position was, where he was, and what he was going to have to do. He understood that he was going to come before a group of people, essentially they were going to reject him. And they did. And we're going to find out something about Jonah and about the people that he goes to that is really interesting, because God really is merciful. And because of Jesus' willingness to live and to die and to be resurrected and to sit at the right hand of the Father, we have great mercy today, because we understand the kingdom of God that is coming to this earth. So let's pick it back up here. He said, pick me up and throw me into the sea. And by the way, remember also that Jesus was asleep in a ship, and the sea was tossing around. And they went over and they were all scared. All these disciples were scared. What's going on? What's happening? He says, oh, you're a little faith. And he waves and he says, wind stop. All the way, and wind stops and he's back to calm. Well, that doesn't work with fish because they have to throw him over. So he says, nevertheless, the men rowed hard to the land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. Therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, we pray, O Lord, please do not let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with his innocent blood, for you, O Lord, have done as it has pleased you. So they picked Jonah up, threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased, and it was from its raging. Then the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered a sacrifice to the Lord and took vows. Now, whether they stayed faithful to God after that, there's no indication about that. But anyway, they were very, very convinced that there was power there. So, now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. So, that always brings us back to what Jesus said. He says they were asking him for a sign. What is the sign? And so he says, there's only one sign for this generation. That I will be in the day for 3 days and three nights. In the earth for 3 days and three nights. And so he went back into the book of Job. And these things were already set up. So it's very interesting as you go through that and you see some things that came right out and Jesus used. So Jonah prayed. He's in the belly of a fish. What else has he got? Oh, Lord, help me. No, his prayer is powerful. His prayer is very strong. He says, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, And he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried. And you heard my voice, for you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas. And the floods surrounded me, and all your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight. Yet I took again towards your holy temple. I looked again towards your holy temple. The water surrounded me even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. I went down in the moorings of the mountains, and the earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you have brought me my life from the pit, O Lord, my God. When my soul faded within me, I remembered the Lord, and my prayer went up to you, into your holy temple. And those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy. But I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. So the Lord spoke to the fish and it vomited Jonah out onto dry land. Now, that's a powerful prayer, but it probably didn't need to go through all that, did it? If he had done the commission in the first place. And you know, sometimes we are, in our own lives, are reluctant to do what God wants us to do. And yet, when we do it, and as Ken has mentioned some of the things that we mentioned about the Sabbath and being obedient to God, when we do it, God blesses us. And the bad part about Jonah is that he becomes kind of angry with God for some reason. And I've still been, with all this time, I've read through it many times, and I thought about Jonah, and I thought about how powerful this situation was that he was in, and what he had to do. And then he becomes angry with the whole point, the whole thing. So let's continue on. A powerful prayer. He's out on the land. Maybe he looked kind of weird after being 3 days and 3 nights in the fish. His belly, I don't know. He took all the hair off. Did he look kind of bleached out? What did he look like when he was coughed up onto the land? The word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time. Jonah, come on now. This is it. Arise, go to Nineveh, a great city, and preach to the message that I tell you. So Jonah arose, went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, 3 days' journey. 3 days' journey. Jonah began to enter into the city the first day, and then he cried out and said, "Yet 40 days, and Nineveh will be overthrown." So the first day, Jonah picks it up and he goes into this city and he begins to preach this message over and over. We find that this city has what is it? 107,000. And it's all right at the end here. 120,000 persons. 120,000 people. A 3 days' journey with 120,000 people that he's got to preach to. Now, of course, we know what it's like when somebody comes through there and all of a sudden the gossip begins to spread and spread and spread. There's a guy walking through our city. And he's telling us to repent. Are we going to repent? Is it that serious? He says in 40 days. The whole of Nineveh is going to be overthrown. So as he walks through this city, day one, day two, and day three. It's interesting, 3 days. Another three, preaching this message. And that's all he's doing, just preaching this message over and over again. And then it's spreading throughout. There's 120,000 people. So what happens? Yeah. Let's go back to Abraham. And let's think about what happened with Abraham and God, and the angels that came, and in this situation, God comes up, tells Abraham, look, the cry of wickedness has come up before me, and I am going to go, and I'm going to check it out. This is Sodom and Gomorrah, and I think there was like five cities all together. But Sodom and Gomorrah are the ones that are mentioned. And so what does Abraham do? He appeals to God. He appeals to God's mercy, doesn't he? If there are 50 people in the city, will you destroy all of them for those 50 righteous people? And God says, no, I don't. If I find 50 righteous people, the cities are preserved. You know, and then it's 25, and then it gets down to 10. And he says, well, okay. If there are 10 righteous people in the city, I will not destroy the city for 10 righteous people. I tell you what, that shows God's mercy, friend. And it also shows that he is willing to listen. He is willing to listen to us. If we come to him and we reach out to him and in our own need, he is willing to listen to what we have to say. And so, unfortunately, the only one is Lot. His wife, he turned back and looked back and turned to Saul and two daughters. They went to a town called Zoar, which was also very wicked, and they ended up in the mountains because of the wickedness of Zoar. But God said that if he found 10 righteous people, he wouldn't destroy it. Well, he didn't find 10 righteous people. He found this Lot. But really, probably just Lot. But he got out of that, and the angels had to pick him up and toss him out. And the angels told him, hey, you can't even look back, because I am going to destroy all of this wickedness. But God was going to be merciful if he could find 10 righteous people in those cities. And he could not. Now, it's interesting to think, when that day comes, that God's wrath is going to have to be poured out on this earth, the wickedness is going to be there. And so, just like in the days of Noah, the wickedness is going to be on the earth, just like in the days of Noah. We're already taking, we're already doing a lot of things in this world, and I'm sure are very upsetting to God. And all the things that he's created, and how he's taught us, and all of those things the truth that that's there and available and to be understood is being overturned by those that want to live in wickedness. So let's find out what the Ninevites actually do. So the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast. Put on sackcloth from the greatest to the least of them. It would be nice if the woman would do that. You know, Jesus, when he came up after fighting with Satan and women, the first thing he does, what does he do? He gets up and he says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. For the world that we live in, and the nation that we live in needs repentance because of the wickedness that is beginning to permeate the society. It's getting more and more difficult in the society that we live in. We see, even in Tulsa, which used to be a fairly quiet town, it seems like there's always a daily murder or something going on, or daily all kinds of things that are happening in this city. So anyway, in Nineveh, they proclaim a fast. And the word came to the king of Nineveh, and he rose from his throne, laid aside his throne, covered himself with sackcloth and sandal ashes. And he caused it to be proclaimed and published throughout Nineveh by a decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Do not let them eat nor drink water. But let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. And who can tell if God will turn and relent and turn away from his fierce anger so that they may not perish? They were actually doing this on faith that what Jonah was saying was going to happen, was true. He says, who can tell if God will turn and relent and turn away from his fierce anger so that we may not perish? And God saw their works. If they had turned from their evil ways, God relented from the disaster that he said that he would bring upon them. And he did not do it. That's divine mercy, by the way. That is divine mercy. That's a wicked city that repents, and the mercy of God reaches out. It's loving kindness for his creation. It's rejoicing for God to see men repent, isn't it? To see men change their lives from the wickedness that they live and the wickedness that they have. To see men change. It is a joy for God to do that and to have mercy on people. All of us have had God's mercy everywhere. When God began to call us out of this world, and he began to pull on us, okay, you're being called out of this world, called, and begin to open the Bible to us, open the Word, help us to understand it more and more, and help us to come to that point in which we can repent of ourselves. Because we see who we are and what we are. Because God reveals it in his Word. I wasn't very early. And God showed me that background wasn't very good either. I had to come to that point, which, yes, I want to be your son. I want to be in your kingdom. I want to have a part in it. And I need to do what needs to be done. The unfortunate part of this wonderful thing that happened, and all of this mercy that came upon this city of Nineveh, was just like a beautiful cloud that came over them. I said, but it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. I don't know what he had. I mean, I'm not sure whether something had happened in his life that the Ninevites had created, or some kind of thing that happened, but he was angry at the miracle that was just performed on these people. So he prayed to the Lord and said, ah, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in the country? Therefore, I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. In Jonah's heart, he knew the character of God. And yet he was angry. He understood how loving God is, how it is that he's willing to reach out and not do harm. Remember the story, and I'm not going there, because all of us are very familiar with it. When Moses goes up into the mountain, and he's getting the tablets and stuff, but down below, the Israelites in the camp, they all are sinning. And they are really sinning. They have created a golden calf. They have done every wicked thing that they could think of to do down there. And they're talking about going back to Egypt, and they're talking about, you know, worshiping this calf and all of this. And Moses is up there receiving the law in the presence of God, in the power of God. And God says, I see what's going on down there. Those people that you brought out of Egypt, I'm going to kill them all. I'm going to start all over with you. I'm saying, Moses, wait a minute. You're going to destroy your own people that you just brought out from? He stood in the breach. And he was in the presence of God and the power of God. And he understood that if God did that, all the nations around him would see that. And so he asked for God's mercy on his own nation. So, yeah. And God relented, even though they were punished. Yeah, they were punished. It's always been interesting because the people that he chose were some of the most rebellious people. Hard, stiff-necked Israelites. They just had a difficult time with all the miracles that they had to see God and see his mercy and see his graciousness and see all of the things that he had. And yet they continued to sin for 40 years in the wilderness. They would gripe and gripe and grumble and all kinds of stuff. And God had to correct them. And sometimes there was so much rebellion, and sometimes they would lose thousands, and sometimes they would go out to battle and God wasn't with them. There was all kinds of things that happened to Israel. And yet, through all of that, do you realize that God still loved and still loves Israel down to this day? And still wants to be the Father, wants to be there for God. Wants to be our God. And we believe and we understand that we love Jesus and we love God the Father and we love what's going on and we understand the kingdom. But we look at some of the things and we say, wow, you have been so very patient. And so I think for each and every one of us, that kind of patience that he has, sometimes when we do things that God doesn't want us to do, and we understand that, and we realize that, that God is there, and he's willing to forgive us, he's willing to be merciful to us. He loves us as his children. So let's go back to Jonah as we finish up here. That's not a very long message today. That's okay. I wanted to just bring this out just because I was thinking about it and just thinking about all the different things that we but I really had a hard time with Jonah. He's seen a miracle. He's seen thousands of people repent. All of a sudden, thousands of people repent. And then he tells God, yeah, I know. Yeah. You're gracious, merciful God, slow to anger, abundant in loving kindness, one in release from being hard. Therefore, now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it's better for me than I ever to live. And so all of us think, oh. And the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? That's a question. Why are you angry? So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city. There he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade till he might see what would become of the city. So he was going to say, well, God's going to keep his word and not destroy it in 40 days. So I'm just going to sit here and watch. And the Lord prepared a plant, made it come up over Jonah, that it might be shade for his head to deliver him from this misery. So Jonah was very grateful for the plant. Interesting, isn't it? But as the morning dawned, the next day, God prepared a worm, and it so damaged the plant that it withered. No more shade. And it happened when the sun arose that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. Then he wished death for himself and said, it is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" He said, "Is it right for me to be angry even to death?" The Lord said, "You have had pity on the plant for which you have not labored, nor made it grow, which came up in the night and perished in the night." Kind of interesting, the relationship that God is having with Jonah. And trying to help him to understand, why are you this way? Why are you so angry? Why have you, are you being this way? And it's interesting that the book of Jonah just ends without really helping us to understand what Jonah really did afterwards. It's almost like it just keeps it in the, keeps Jonah in the dark, doesn't it? God says, "And should I not have pity? And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city in which are more than 120,000 persons who cannot discern between the right hand and the left, and much livestock?" Because what was the original intent? If they didn't repent, God was going to destroy them like Sodom and Gomorrah. That was how wicked they were. That was the situation. And Jonah, knowing God, being that kind of a loving God, because that's what he is, a loving God, he's graceful, gracious and merciful, has divine mercy. Sometimes we don't understand why he's so merciful, but it's divine mercy. He knows we're best. He knows we're weak. He knows us. He knows our frame. And so when he comes to the end, he says, "This is all these people. They're not going to perish. Why are you angry, Jonah?" Then I think about Jesus and the situation that he found himself in. And after he came up out of the baptism, and he began to walk among his own people, and he began to preach, and he began to heal, and he began to miracle after miracle after miracle. And they rejected him. He even went to his own city, and he read right out of the book of Isaiah, and he told him, he says, "A prophet is not honored even in his own city." And they were so angry with him, they wanted to stone him to death and not kick him over the walls or something. And he had to flee. He had to leave. He came to his own people and they rejected him. God had given this most powerful opportunity. I mean, Jesus was healing. He was preaching to thousands. He was healing and casting demons out. And all kinds of things were, powerful things were happening around him. I mean, a lady touched the hem of his garment and she was healed. Another lady who was, he said, "Well, I come to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. I can't help you because you're not of that tribe." And she says, "Yeah, but she says, "The crumbs that fall off the table for the dogs, that's me. That's what I am." And Jesus saw her faith. He says, "The demon has left your child." That was so powerful. To understand what Jesus was going through, to understand all the things that he was having to go through as he was preaching and teaching and he was healing and he was teaching his disciples and he was walking through different things and he was, all of this that we have to understand. And then, what do they do at the end? They reject Jesus completely. Crucify him. Crucify him. And we go back to the book of Jonah, 3 days and 3 nights, and the heart of the earth. and faithfulness. God resurrects him out of that. And today, he sits at the right hand of the Father in heaven. So we can see some things of the mercy, the love, the concern for, I think, there's always, it's like he was reading where the watchman, the need to continue to watch what's going on in the world. And there's a lot of people that are very aware of what's happening, and very aware of what, you know, the things that are happening in the world, and very aware of the situations. We live in a dangerous society, don't we? But we have a great hope, that's our Savior Jesus Christ. We have a great hope because we're going into a period of time of Feast of Tabernacles that is expanding our understanding of God's great plan on the earth. We will intervene. We will bring about this kingdom. And we will have a wonderful part of that. Because he has also been very merciful, and he'll be merciful to many, many. And as many as come and repent, they will have the opportunity to be in his kingdom.